Give an impression about the kinds of environments. requirements that we have for action grid. This is a list of some of the instantiations of the SmartConnect instance that we have. So we talk to ARIS, to Archi, to the Archimate exchange standard, BiZZdesign, Smart Enterprise. And those of you who model themselves, you will recognize some of these requirements.
Do you have them for Magic Draw?
We don't have one for Magic Draw, but there's, it's not that it's not possible, but we haven't had to request it. So, given the architecture that I will show you, it is very possible to make a similar extension that connects to our to the Magic Draw, basically to any other environment, provided that this environment has the opportunity to publish its content in some structured way. Usually XML or XML or something like that. So, while I'm doing this, I'll take you through this architecture and through this function of this SmartConnect by means of a running example. I will take it from the connection of ARIS to the setup we use. Now, ARIS is one of these modeling environments that you can easily replace depending on the environment that you can think of. And I will be talking about this little model here. I'm not sure if it's readable from the back. By the way, this is a screenshot from one of our actual rooms. So you see here is the visual representation of the model that has been modeled in ARIS, has been read in. There is the image map representation of that model. But it shows you the green boxes are process sets, processes. This is a visual representation, but obviously within the wiki, we also have a model representation. So we have a page for the process on the left side, we have a page for the event, we have a page for the other process, and there are indeed connected.
And you can link to the pages from each of these symbols?
Oh yeah, there's an image map. So if you click on one of the symbols here, you can jump to the page in the wiki that represents it. So, the way that we constructed this selection is by means of a pipeline. And the way that this works is, on the one hand, we have a data export. So, we run a reborn script within the ARIS moving environment. And this creates an XML file. And we have some metadata in there as well. And then there's a special page in the wiki, just a special ARIS import. They can upload. Then it's like processing. And all it does is it reads in the export and it starts doing some things with it. It filters out any elements that you don't want to see. It maps the structure that's within the modeling environment to the meta model that you use in the week. And eventually, of course, it imports the result of that process. And each of these steps throughout the pipeline can actually be tailored towards the requirements of the customer. Because obviously, any wiki can have any metadata. Whereas the model structure from the modeling environment is fixed, the structure that you want to use after processing differs quite a lot between different customers. So it's a very, very specific little pipeline draw. I will go into more detail about each of these sets and what it actually does. Why a pipeline? Well, we started off with modeling. So we just had a special page, you would upload it, then a special page to do the processing, and then after a while, we have done the. This works quite well until you run into customized utility. Because every customer has their own requests and their own requirements. You need to have a lot of applications. If you have a monolithic extension, you start having a whole load of if statements. switch things like that, and it becomes unmaintainable. So this runs well for just one or two customers, as soon as you have more, then it becomes something that can no longer be maintained. So, the canonical way of treating that is modelleing. The part of the realization we use is this pipeline. And this has some benefits too. It gives you a chain of responsibility. So you really decouple the origination of the model, the export, from the import and everything that happens in between. So you can also vary the ways you want to start the import. You have it as an upload, you have it as a schedule, you have it as a batch oriented process, maybe a real time connection. But you can also vary in the output. We write it now to loop, but we may want to write it to other systems. We can use the exact same final configuration. And it makes it possible to have adaptable behavior of different systems. So we can just use inheritance and interfaces and properties like that to differ between behavior for different final configurations. So the model that I showed you earlier, these three or four elements, if you look at the structure from the modeling environment, it's something like this. So our sets will work with things that we call object depths, which is an object definition, and CXN depths, which are connection definitions, and obviously object depths and CXN depths are connected, and connect again to other object definitions, etc. And these definitions have types. For objects, they have two types, especially the simple number here is important. For connections, they have one type. The start value, a bit about the role that it plays in the model. It is quite difficult. If you look at it, you really must understand what an NS fundamental procedure leads to is to understand what the model that represents is. You also see attributes, a name, obviously, that is the name of the element, it has a technical identifier. To it, everything here to it, which is good. Because we can use that to determine on communications. But there's more. That's the modeling side of the equation. There's also the visual side of the equation. So within the export model, you also encounter things that are called object occurrences. And this is what you actually see on the model. They're connected under the roof to the model side of the equation. You see things like set orders, gradients, and symbols, and things like that. So this is what we have to work with. This is what we get, and then we have to process it to come up with some sort of a wiki page definition that conforms to the meta model that we want to use. One other element, one other ingredient that we can use is related to the smart world. It's quite a simple object model solution, but we use this extensively throughout the time to be able to manipulate this import in terms of objects. So what we have here is relations, elements, identifiers, and properties. It's in a sense just a representation of the way that it's meant to be used. But we have implemented this PHP so we can actually model. This is a prerequisite for the things that we do. So the first step in this pipeline is reading the model. What we do is we make a literal translation from the technical model that I just shared with the chance of the modeling environment to do this smart model. So here you see smart relevance, smart relations, smart relevance types, which are directly filled with the input that comes from the export model. So you see a smart element which has some kind of a technical ID with a relation which is an ID sequence to, and it has a property a name with a value that's the name of the element. And this connection to the object relation. Obviously, this is not what you want to import, but this is not the model that you want to query, if you want to use the masters or show properties from to the end user. So we're going to do a couple of things with this. The first thing we do is we get rid of the technical IDs and technical name. So we run a method. And we know from the metadata export what the user labels are that are used for each of these technical terms. So instead of 18 labels, now says name. Instead of some weird internal ID, it now says the actual page name, which is by the way construct of the name of the object, the element, the type of element, and the user. So that we always have the unique page name, which is obviously one of the prerequisites of MediaWiki. You see that it's now no longer less in fun, but it's a process example that the end user actually understands. And all of these are processes in one here. Then the next thing is that we want to get rid of some of the things we need. So for instance, we have this export gate in the middle. We don't want pages in the wiki that correspond to export gates. I'm not going to look at them in the dump query. We just want to connect whatever processes are connected to events via export gates. We just want to make a connection directly. So that's the next step. There's another component in this file that looks at the model, looks at the connections that are in there, finds the XOR base, and gets rid of it. And then rerouting the connections the way that you actually expected and then use it. So this already starts to correspond to the meta model that we use in the loop. But we still have these object occurrences, and there may be some other things that we don't need. We don't need to process them, we just want to get rid of them. So that's the final step in here. Which would say, well, these things are not needed. We can just delete them from the model that we are building up. But now what we have is actually a object model representation of what we want to import to the loop. So that the final stage is that we actually serialize this to Wiki text, which is a stride recognizable. One thing, surprise memory cache there. But that has to do with the smart array. So it's actually what we'll do here is we run the template tool through a parser function. The parser function then is responsible for accepting the semantic properties. So, if you start looking, what are the needs of the benefits? Most of them are technical. Some of them have to do more with the coding procedure of running it. One of the interesting things we're running into failure maps. Because what might happen is that someone made a mistake and a typo in the process. It says input instead of input. And then obviously in the modeling environment we just get rid of the second key. But if we build up a page by looking at the name of the element, it's all of a sudden we have a different page. Well, here the Google is coming. But what we do is we first look into it, and we sort of do it as semantic properties. And we just query for the GUI. And if we find any page that has a GUI, we assume that it is a previous version of the page that we have now. And then we do a page reaction within the GUI. And then you're pretty certain that, it's a GUI, so it's globally, so you're pretty certain that the thing that you have found is indeed a rename action. Now another thing is deletions. This is not a big deal if you have full imports. You just have a whole model of the semantic environment. Because then you can do a comparison between what you have and what you have received and anything that's in addition in the wiki, you can delete because apparently it's not only model. But what we do a lot is partial imports. So we know that we have some metadata that tells us which models have been exported. But we don't know whether what's not a model is actually deleted because it's maybe used in another model. So we can't say we don't have boundaries, we should get rid of it. So what we do here is we actually add some metadata properties to the modeling environment. You can record in the modeling environment that something might be deleted, just a Boolean flag. You run the export, you run the import, and you have to delete like a whole tree. Part of the import, by the way, brings a lot of other interesting challenges, which have to do with determining the scope of the import. So that's the thing to next consistent model. You have to draw boundaries on it, because otherwise you end up with half reinforced pages. And what we do to make this possible is, like I said, we add metadata to the export so that we can properly interpret the scope of the. And then there is also the custom-made processing rules that we use to, for instance, say we don't want to have absorbates. Sometimes they want them, sometimes they not. But that's really something that is decided from the interaction between the interface. Something different that comes up if you do things like this is more to the procedural side. If you have some processing rules, then the processors expect the export to be in a certain order. It expects there to be one gate in between events and processes, not a series of three, for instance. And if then someone starts modeling a series of three XOR gates, the processing group does not understand how to do it. So here you really need to have some modeling guidelines and you need to be followed by the modeling team. This may be challenging. So, what our conclusion is, at least in our practice, Semantic does not really run in isolation. We really see a lot of connections from other environments. And what we also see is that most of the imports that we follow a similar structure. That's why we could model this at this pipeline. So, modular operations follow this pipeline paradigm, modular data. There's some things that we have not yet implemented, but that we are thinking of for our own development. Right now, it's an import pipeline. We could also convert. We could also use the data from Semantic to export it to other environments. Something that I find very exciting, and I would really like to explore more, is now we're not importing at the instance of it, so we have model data that we import. Wouldn't it be very cool if we could also import metadata? So we just have an island somewhere. We import it, and all of a sudden, the whole forms, all the classes, all the templates that we need. It should be doable, but we could use the same pipeline circuit. Like I said, it can vary with the import and the export size of the. We are looking into other ways of uploading, of manually uploading, of having better-oriented. Schedule, real-time rules connecting to services at the modeling environment side. We also see opportunities to use this pipeline not only to provide to Semantic, but to other environments as well. Maybe with Semantic, we can have an intermediate import and export and then another form. And something that has to do with the modeling guidelines, we are thinking about checking rules. So we can do some technical validation of the biology that we have been provided with, but that doesn't ensure that the semantics of the model are correct. That's something that we will be looking further into, whether it's possible to have semantic model validation rules to apply to the model that we have in the object model, and then to see whether any modeling is safe. This may help people who use modeling environments to really comply with what they intend to be modeling, and what they intend to be telling you when they contribute to something. So that's what we've been doing and what we're still doing. But now if there's any questions about things I'm still about.
Yeah, interesting about the presentation. We were focusing on the meta level, see, at least in my perspective, that we work with models and architectures and standards that describe how the system should run. And we found great ways to use those, namely, essentially, to help set the models and set the standards that the models work to help other people handle the information systems. But you can also build an information system, of course, on Semantic. Do you do that already, or do you see possibilities in how you could automatically translate what you read in the Semantic
tomorrow there will be a talk about, I'll just show the screenshot of one of these wikis and how it goes to them. This is a screenshot from a ghost walker, which is used within a big bang, in order to gather ghost information, ghost knowledge, and the word instructions that the people on the forge should follow to ghost people. So they use the happiness in big handles, for instance, and now this is a way of publishing that much more directly. But it's still in the sense of a meta level, as you say, but it really has implications for people doing the actual work of the
people.
So the reason we have a parser function there is that we use templates and we use them extensively. It's templates that run templates. As you know, we run into performance issues, we do that a lot. So what we did is we pushed some of the templates running templates into a parser function so that we can gauge the performance because we then are closer to the PHP segment. It's just performance. But under the loop, everything we do. It used to be solely in templates. So everything we build has to build in, except from this file, the whole part was using templates.
Presentation. I think we kind of have this use case, and we were trying to use the semantic intervention for this purpose. We actually use semantic for and we export logs and more than this. Can you just talk a little bit more around some of the mapping? So if I just take specifically, I have a UML class diagram where I've got an association M. It's a complex class. So where do you hold that mapping into how you present that in the semantic MediaWiki? That translation into a category or a page, how does that work?
It's another special page where you can register these mappings. So if we are able to extract these mappings from the metadata that the modeling environment gives us, we use that. You can always override it because you may not want to use the default data, for instance. So if you would not want to map 18 name to the property name, you would have a rule on the special page which says AP name, then an arrow and it says first name. Then you would use the property first name. That's how we register the name.
Okay. So do you currently use a meta model to do that? So if we say, for example, we've got different models in our modeling environment that complies to a certain meta model, adhering to the rules of that meta model, would you then use that meta model to set up all those special pages and those mappings?
Yes, first of all, yeah.
Is that the approach?
That's the approach. Although implementing this meta model would be still something to do within the region, and then the pipeline would make it able to transform this export to the implemented meta model. But perhaps we should take this question online because Marty Guti is going to respond.
Unfortunately, the time is over. And thank you very much, Remco.
Thank you.